Welcome, iRacers, to Apex Racing TV, and what very much feels like our return to the home of iRacing Grand Prix Series. Feels like a long time since we've covered one of these races. My name is Lee Thompson. I'm joined in the commentary booth by Alex Simpson, World Championship Series driver. Evening, Alex. Guys out there putting their qualifying laps for their run at the Road to Pro.
Yeah, evening, Lee. Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining us, watching it back on YouTube. Like you say, so full circle, and great to be back. I just remember doing these back in sort of 2012. It was changed a little bit as the sim since then, but drivers qualifying now before the race, the first of the changes, gives us a little bit more time to get into the sim.
Yeah, the guys have got just 2 minutes left until this qualifying session is over. It looks like pretty much every car is out on track, trying desperately to get those extra couple of hundredths or tenths and work their way up the grid. Currently in provisional pole is George Montanez, and we'll see if he can hold that in these remaining couple of minutes. As you say, few changes since we have last visited the iRacing Grand Prix Series. Like I say, the most obvious one being what we're seeing now of qualifying pre-race. They have 12 minutes to qualify. The other main one that's really helped this last couple of seasons is that they've got fixed weather for every single race, and so it makes it much easier for people to be able to figure out setups, and perhaps someone like Alex sharing setups to the community helps to build those numbers up a little bit, which is what's really needed in this series.
Yeah, we've been doing that for a couple of seasons now. Seems to have helped out quite a bit, and like you say, the weather, just looking at that on the screen at the moment, quite cloudy out there at the moment, track temperature down at 21 degrees, so tyres not so sensitive to the thermal problems that might exist when we're up at, say, the high 30s or 40 degrees, so a lot of grip out there for the guys for this race.
And this is week 8 of season 2, and what the guys are ultimately looking for is to get into the top 15 positions at the end of the season, and those are the guys that will qualify for those pro positions. And having a quick scan through the list, looks like we've got the majority of the runners in this session are the guys who are indeed fighting for those positions. So a quick look at the season standings as to who is going to be fighting for those top 15 spots. Currently in first position of the season is Pablo Lopez, ex-WCS driver, currently just with an A-class license. So Pablo Lopez, then we've got Kevin Siggy in second with Cam Stark in third, Ricardo Torres in fourth with Martin van Luzenden in fifth, Johnny Backman in 6th with Diogo Oliveira in 7th, Pepe de la Harris in 8th, Juan Luis Alfaro in 9th, Tim Berti in 10th, Vincenzo Amico in 11th, Daniel Bieder in 12th, Timo Valcavage in 13th, Valez Remyek in 14th, and then Fabio Gonzalez has currently got 15th position. So those are the guys who are currently holding the overall season standings for those 15th positions. Right, so session is coming to an end. Checkered flag is out. Is there anyone else still on lap? We've got Cyprian still on, Daniel Benefield. We've got a few cars still completing their laps, so we'll give it a second longer before we confirm the final grid.
Yeah, just been watching Daniel. Seems like a pretty good lap from him. Doesn't seem to have made any mistakes there. Cam Mac aborted a lap we saw on camera as well, so just got a little bit out of shape out of club corner. Still tricky as ever, I see.
And very last
Daniel
car
does improve, but doesn't move up too much further.
Yeah, and the very last car coming over the line now is Cyprian, so we'll see if he improves from his current 19th position. Doesn't look like that he does. So the grid we've got then is George Montanez did hold on to that pole position, in fact improved his time by a bit over a tenth as well, so he's got a 1 minute 18.126. Lining up alongside him in second place is going to be Mac Backham, with Ricardo Torres then in third and Peter Berryman in fourth, Martin van Luzendoord in fifth with Fabio Gonzalez in sixth, Diogo Oliveira in seventh and Pepe de la Harris in eighth, Ricky Alatalo in ninth with Daniel Bieder in tenth, Petteri Cotavara in 11th, Juan Luis Alvaro in 12th, John Oncala in 13th, George Lee Wright in 14th, Tumu Valcajariv, oh, I butchered your surname even worse than the first time, I do apologise, I'll get my head around that, 15th, Johnny Takkinen in 16th, Daniel Benefield in 17th, Kleber Alvin Toffoli in 18th, with Cyprian Briscoe, not improving on that 19th. Klaus Seimitz in 20th, and Francisco Javier Gutierrez in 21st and final position. So everybody is lining up on the grid as we speak. A good number of them are right on the bend that we have coming out of the last complex at the circuit. It's going to make it all that bit more tricky to try and get off the line.
Yeah, Silverstone starts, like you say, that's the place you don't want to be, is it, on the little corner there, so easy to light up those rear wheels and just get a little bit out of shape, so we'll keep an eye out for that, I'm sure, but yeah, the front runners all get a clean start. Waiting for the final few drivers to take to the grid, just Mac, I think we're waiting for in the Radicals car. We were talking about Mac just briefly off air that he's making a run for this, but he's quite late to the season, so he needs sort of, we were saying, sort of 270 points a race. So last one he got 260, so he's going to hope for a slightly stronger strength of field.
Yeah, it looks like we've got everyone on here. I can hear the revs building, waiting for the green flag to drop for week 8 at Silverstone iRacing Grand Prix Series. And the lights are off and we're away. Great start in the background, I think, from Rico Alatella, who's going to make up three or four spots if he stays clean. Montanez holds on to first as he comes into Cox.
Yeah, good start there for Montanez. Mack, though, having a little bit of a run already. Maybe in through Beckett's Maggots. Yeah, side by side. This is going to be good around the outside. What a great move already. So perhaps a little bit lighter already. But yeah, Montanez just couldn't hold it around the outside there. Sorry, on the inside.
Yeah, so we've got Matt Back and then George, then we've got Ricardo Torres, then we've got Peter Berryman, and Rico Alatello is up into what's that fifth position, looking to challenge for fourth on Peter Berryman. He's going to be able to cut back to the inside as they come out of Stowe, down into the heavy braking zone of Vale. He's going to be on the outside though, but Ricky brakes much, much later, drives straight around the outside of Peter, inside line now for club, and he has got that position made. Peter's going to lose another position as he gets very, very close to Martin as they exit club.
Yeah, it's Diego Oliveira, they're side by side, still hold it through there. Abby, not the easiest place to go too wide. Oh, and there's probably a little bit of netcode contact, and Peter's around and into the wall. That's probably his race done and dusted right there.
Yeah, it looked a little bit clumsy initially, and then just everyone had nowhere to go. So Mac Backham trying to build a little bit of a gap already on Montanez, so he's looking to break that draft. Ricardo Torres is a little bit closer, and Rico Alatella now has got to be a clean track in front of him to build on that fourth position. The field has got strung out a little bit from the instant towards the end of the lap there. And Peter Berryman has indeed disconnected as expected with that damage.
Yeah, he jumped in very much last minute, having a little chat with us, wasn't he? And I think he's going to regret that one now.
So, scrolling back through field, main nice little group we've got building at the minute is P8 downwards. So, Daniel Bida, 8th, Petteri Quartararo in 9th, Georgie Wright in 10th, Juan Alfaro in 11th, and Timu in 12th. So, that looks like the group of battling a minute. And a car under pressure a little bit of a minute is Quartararo from Georgie Wright. So as they head into Vale, we'll see how that shakes out over the next couple of laps.
Yeah, Petteri returning back to the F1. It's been a long, long time since we've seen him, but made the call to jump back in there. He's going to have to perhaps go a little bit defensive. Georgie Wright up the inside into Abbey. Just can't quite make the move stick there. Petteri saw that coming, just went a little bit deep in defence there. But yeah, so one of the Galicia drivers back in the car. I think it's more to do with the McLaren coming to the series in the future, and wants to get back up into the pro spots and maybe retain his or return to the World Championship.
Yeah, definitely has sparked a few returning names this year, hasn't it? The news of the 2015 McLaren coming to iRacing. I think everybody's very much looking forward to that. You know, the Williams has done well over the years, but it's definitely time for a change. Back up front, Mac Backham is streaking away. He's a good 3 seconds ahead of George Montanez, with Ricardo Torres now under lots and lots of pressure from Rico Alatello. So Rico looking to move up into that third spot within a lap or so, I would say. He blows quite a lot down hangar straight there as they head into Stowe.
Yeah, I wonder if Ricky's perhaps a little bit light. Definitely looks like he's got good pace out there. So 120.8 last time by Montanez and Torres, both in the 21. But yeah, Mac absolutely flying over 120.2. So awesome pace out there.
And still we've got this train of cars back from P8 all the way down now to, well, pretty much last on the track almost, at 18th position, Daniel Benefield. He is at the back of that little train. And as you say, it's going to be interesting to see how any little strategy differences shape up and whether we do get any significant movements through these cars. It's obviously one of the quickest circuits that we see on the season, but equally that can make it pretty challenging to get runs on people when you're coming through these fast corners and you're missing the aero from being tucked underneath the car in front.
Yeah, dirty air, always tricky. Changed a little bit since you drove it as well, I think, Lee, because you start get it about half a second and you don't get any advantage up until that point as well. So it's a lot smaller now, so you see the guys run up to about that half a second mark and then it just becomes like a brick wall that they hit. So in Silverstone, known to be particularly tricky for the dirty air.
And I'm looking at Johnny Takkinen under lots of pressure from Kleber Toffoli as they come through Stowe, but Kleber maybe running a little bit hot as he was looking to challenge that position, actually has ended up losing out himself and is under pressure himself from Cyprian Brascuru. It's interesting to see. Yeah, so you haven't been away from IGPS for a little while. It's interesting to see some new names, some names from other series maybe who I've seen work their way up. So George Lee Wright, for instance, now in F1, I've seen him in Skip Barber and other lower Formula. And also interesting to see people still running in the F1 car from a good couple of years ago, such as Cyprian, for instance. That's a name that has certainly been around for a significant time in this Williams.
Yeah, talking to Cyprian, he just lost a place there to Klaus, I think it was. Just run a little bit deep into Abbey chicane there, and had to get right out of it. And Klaus just got the run coming off the corner into bridge. So yeah, pretty straightforward overtake for Klaus there. Okay, so someone running wide. I think that was Daniel Benningfield running very, very wide through turn one. Just about hold on to it there, but very easy to lose the car around there, but manages to hold on, but lost about half a second.
I'm presuming, Alex, we're expecting a pit stop from these guys. How are they doing with tyre wear, or is it purely just about the fuel load that they're carrying?
Yeah, no, I think it's all about tyre wear actually now, so it's just they do drop off a little bit, and I would expect to see them in any time from sort of lap 22 to 27, something like that, I think, with what we've seen so far this week. So I'd be surprised if we see any two-stoppers. 60% race distance from normal Grand Prix in the IGPS this season, bar, I think, three rounds that are doing 100%, but Silverstone's not one of them. So, yeah, just the one stop is what we're expecting.
Well, we've got a little group forming now almost from third position, Ricardo Torres, with Rico Alatalu still behind him, back to Diogo Oliveira. He's almost closed onto the back of Riku. Martin van Luzenord is hanging on, getting pulled along as well by Diogo. So, yeah, four car group forming from third position down, and then we've still got, this train of cars has broken apart a little bit from eighth position, Daniel Beda, down to George Lee Wright in 10th, and then we've got a bit more of a gap now to Juan Alfaro, and then the cars leading back from there. So yeah, not quite that long train we had in the opening laps. It looks like Cotavara is looking to try and push forward. He's closed a bit more in the last lap and a half or so on Daniel Beda ahead, and in fact is much, much cleaner through Vale. He's going to get a much better exit, I think, coming out of club as they head now down towards the far chicane at Abbey, but not able to close enough to challenge on a brake stoping.
Yeah, I had a little thought about it, but like you say, tricky to get enough of a run into Abbey. You really need the drivers to make a little mistake there, don't you, out of club, and that gives you the opportunity. But yeah, Beda running very, very wide through Priory?
Yeah, after Bridge. So Ricardo Torres now is under a lot more pressure from Rico Alatello again, even just in that half a lap. Riku has closed by a good few more tenths. It seems like what you were talking about a minute ago, Alex, where perhaps Riku's now going to be hitting that brick wall a little bit, and it's going to take a mistake from Ricardo in front for him to really be able to progress any further. But they work their way down a hangar straight, and the whole time again, Diogo Oliveira is trying to close and make this a four-car group.
Yeah, Martin behind as well, slowly closing in. So, like you say, I think we're going to have a pretty good four-car battle before long, especially if Ricciardo and Ricciardo just start having a little tussle as well.
Yeah, and in fact, their lap times last time by are kind of perfect for us seeing something. So Ricciardo Torres was the slowest of the group with a 0.8, then Ricciardo with a 0.7, then Oliveira with a 0.5, and then Martin with a 0.4. So that's exactly the way we want it, trying to close the group up, give us a bit of entertainment to see how their tussles turn out.
To switch our focus just for a second, a little bit further back, Daniel Bida still under a lot of pressure from Petteri Cotovaro, and George Lee Wright still holding on in there as well. So an interesting three car battle. They've lost one Alfa Romeo behind them as well, so he's lapping around the same sort of pace, so I'm not really sure why he's dropped off, but there's quite a train formed up behind him as well, so Timu and Yoni. There's good little separation of packs, but a lot of fighting going on out there at the moment.
Yeah, we've got 19 cars still running with the instant and the opening lap, taking out Peter Behrmann and Juan Gonzalez. So yeah, plenty of cars to keep things interesting for us. George Lee Wright is as close as he's been to Petteri Cotovaro for a good few laps as they come through Stowe, but doesn't quite get the exit to be able to challenge at all. It's interesting seeing George in here. When he first joined iRacing, he quickly developed not a great reputation, shall we say, but to see him in these top standings in the pros, in the Road to Pro, you know, he's in the top 20 positions, I think, trying to squeeze into that top 15. It shows he must be getting that consistency and getting the race results. And seeing him running here with, you know, say Petteri, who, you know, is an experienced ex-WCS driver, that's quite a transformation that he's managed to put together, and running at a consistent pace with these very, very experienced iRacing drivers.
Yeah, good on him. Maybe matured just a little bit. I haven't seen any sort of post or anything like that. He's definitely got a little run this time. Perhaps Petteri, having to defend, backs out of it, decides it's better just to wait there. So yeah, that just really confirms what we're saying here. Just matured a little bit as a driver. The George that we knew so well there would have just dived for a move up the inside there, but thinks better of it, wait for a better time. It's just a little bit late to make a move there, but yeah, that's of course Petteri's lost the draft of Daniel Bida now, so that's going to make him a little bit more vulnerable down and into places like Stowe.
It's been a good few years, or it feels like a good few years now, since iRacing announced that they had scanned the revised layout here at Silverstone, so it's a shame we are yet to see that and see Petteri Cotovaro going past the new wing complex that is now present. I'm sure we're going to see that one day. It'll be interesting to see them working on that inside layout and that scarily fast right-hander at Abbey instead of chicane that we have now. But for now, we are remaining on the old GP circuit that doesn't really exist in real life anymore, as Mac Backham begins lap 10 with a 1 minute 19.9. Looks like he is the only car under 1 minute 20, and he is building more and more of a comfortable gap to Montanez in second.
Yeah, awesome pace again. I just touched on that. So we know Mac, obviously a previous pro driver, didn't turn up for last season's pro series, so he wants
Ricciu,
to get back in.
Sorry, Alex. Ricciu has got a run coming down hangar straight. Daniel Bida struggled, I think, through, or Ricciardo Torres rather, struggled through Maggots Beckett's. And yeah, Ricciu Alessandro hanging it around the outside of Stowe. And oh, Ricciardo Torres gets a little bit loose and exit. Rear comes around, manages to pedal hacks his save, keep it out the wall, loses a couple of positions, and manages to carry on unharmed. So Ricciu Alatalo up into third, and in fact has Diogo is still ahead of Martin just behind, so yeah, Ricciu Alatalo up to third.
Yeah, just having a little look at the replay of the overtake, staying with Ricciardo Torres to see what happened there. And yeah, like you say, just got a little bit loose coming off there, trying to get on the power as early as possible to see if he can stay side by side with Ricciu. And yeah, in the end, just fails and loses himself three further spots.
So it'll be interesting to see if Riku can pull away from those two behind now that he has got a clear track and he's not got that dirty air to worry about. But Martin is much, much closer now to Diogo as they come through Maggots Beckett's again, and be interesting to see what kind of exit they both managed to get. I think Diogo done well to make sure it's a clean exit. He's got the tow from Riku, so nothing doing for now. And scrolling back, I think everybody else has just spread out that little bit more, and there's really nothing doing for now. Everyone line astern, so it's all going to be about, what, another 10 laps or so, and see what sort of times people come in for their pit stops. In and out laps can make a massive, massive difference, of course, let alone the choice of what lap you come in on. And it'll be very interesting to see how that shapes things out in the second half of the race.
Yeah, I think strategy always seems to be quite key, especially at Silverstone. We'll see a few drivers trying to get the jump, stay in that extra lap, stay out that extra lap longer, and just get that overcut. So it seems to be the story. So I don't really see any drivers that appear to be overly heavy compared to their competitors at the moment. So yeah, we'll have to see what it is. I mean, Max just flying away, so I can't think Montana's going to do any kind of jump in there, even if he's like 6 or 7 laps longer. So, but yeah, this little pack in the middle, maybe we could see some changes there come 9 laps time.
So now that Riku has that clear track in front of him, he laps half a second quicker than Diogo and Martin behind. So he is going to quickly pull himself into a bit of a no man's land. Montaner's managed to scrape into the 19s that lap as well, but still McBacken was 0.2 quicker again.
Yeah, absolutely flying out there. Actually, why don't we, next time he comes by the start finish line, Lee, why don't you take us on board for a lap around Silverstone?
Yeah, so McBacken, as you say, he's got a lot of work to do, you said, this season, with coming in late and having to score big, big points to claw himself up into that Pro Series, but it's already been a pretty good week for him so far, it looks like. So he comes out of the final corner, works his way onto the pit straight, crosses the start-finish line, he's got cops in front of him. That is going to be just a slight lift, possibly down a gear, and try not to run too wide. You can use all of that curve, but as soon as you touch the AstroTurf, the car's just going to keep pushing out. Maggots, or Chapel Maggots Beckett's, so a very, very fast entry, and just continuously slowing the car down, trying to compromise kind of each previous corner to give the next corner the best exit that you can. Down onto Hangar Straight and heading towards Stowe, down a couple of gears, you're turning quite early really and let the car carry around quite a long apex on the inside, over to the right, ready for the heaviest braking on the circuit, down into Vale, clobber this inside curb. Be careful a bit more of this next one, and then gently on the throttle through club again. In the weather that we have now, it's a little bit easier, I feel, exiting club than I remember it being back in the day. Heavy braking now for Abbey again, inside curb, just a little bit of a touch from Mac there, running over the exit curb, through bridge, fast corner, try and get all the way over to the right, onto the grass even for Mac there as he turns in. Hard on the brakes again for Brooklands, straighten up the exit. And now he's just got this final corner to go that goes on forever and ever and ever. Use as much of an exit curb as you can. And that already is a lap on Silverstone in under 1 minute and 20 seconds. I suspect, 1 minute 19.7 for Mac that time.
Yeah, a great lap from Mac. And pretty much nailed every apex there. So definitely a driver that's on form at the moment. While we're away, it looks like the front little pack from sort of 3rd, 4th, 5th definitely spread out quite a bit.
Oh, we are missing a car, Alex. Martin has gone, so he was running very, very close to Diogo.
Yeah,
and
so another little...
he's in 6th now, sorry.
Yeah, so he was further up. So Ricardo Torres has dropped back as well. He's now behind Daniel Beda, so in between Daniel and Pateri as well, so... Yeah, something must have perhaps gone on between those two, are we thinking? I don't know. I'll see if I can bring something up at the end of the race.
Ricardo had his little moment, didn't he, when Riku tried to go by, so I think that's where he was after his half spin. So I think it was just Martin that has lost one position. But we'll see. But yeah, that group now has closed back up, actually, hasn't it? And so yeah, Ricardo Torres is almost at the front of that, with Daniel Beda just in, you know, an arm's reach away. Petr Kotovar has still got Joel Schlierite for company, as he's had all race. Alfaro then, and Timu just behind, and yeah, almost bring themselves together into one big group again.
Yeah, actually, I think that's going to make strategy all the more important. Just looking at the gaps at the moment, I'm looking at from 17th, which is Daniel Beda, we've got 20 seconds beyond the leader, all the way down to Cyprian in 16th, covered by 9 seconds. So, yeah, definitely could be some movers with the pit stop strategy in and around that sort of cluster at the moment. So.
Yeah, and it's going to be a tough decision to make for some of these guys. You know, it could be a little bit of track position issues maybe for the very front guys. So I'm thinking that the top four cars, after they come out of the pits, you know, they could well come out in amongst some of the pack behind. Whereas that main group, you know, they know that if they pit, they're then going to have a clean empty track really in front of them. So it's going to be more advantageous maybe for those guys towards the back to pit a bit early, give themselves a clear run and see if they can jump themselves forward a few positions, but we shall wait and see how it all plays out. At the minute, everybody is just spaced out that a little bit more, nobody really challenging to make a move for now. Probably the closest two cars together is John Onkala in 5th and Martin van Lusendoort in 6th, trying to recover that position.
Yeah, they were separated by less than a second, but it just looks like John had a pretty good lap that last time by and pulled away, so, or should we say a bad lap from Martin, so back into the 121, so haven't seen that for a little while from him, so yeah, just struggled a little bit that lap. George Leroy again getting pretty close to Pateri, just a half a second separating those two again. Terry lost a little bit of ground on Ricardo Torres that lap as well, so a couple of tenths of a second, but I dare say that was probably just getting into that dirty air zone again and just dropping back out.
Yeah, you'd almost expect Petri to be running maybe a little bit further forward in this field with his experience, but you know, it certainly takes time to get back up to speed in this car. And I do wonder as well, I mean, Glacier have lost a couple of big names over the last few seasons to other teams, and you wonder maybe whether they haven't quite got the depth of knowledge perhaps with setups as well.
Yeah, maybe. Of course, you know, the names you're talking about are Lexi Uciacola and Olli Pekkala, so those guys racing for Redline right now and, you know, doing extremely well in the World Championship. So, yeah, I'm sure for Glacier, it was a shame to see them go, but on the other hand, it was great for those two drivers because they, you know, proved their worth in the 2014 season. So, but yeah, perhaps like you say, struggling a little bit because they haven't got those guys to fall back on to help them out. But I dare say they probably give a little lending hand every now and again anyway.
And of course, we have got his teammate Rico Alatello up in 3rd. So, yeah, we know there's certainly the potential in the car. So it's just Petri getting himself back up to speed a little bit, maybe. But yeah, still this group of cars in the middle of the pack here, all running pretty much line astern. Martin has managed to close by a few more tenths again after that bad lap, you said. He ran then a second quicker bit of that lap than he did the previous one. So yeah, he did have a scruffy one. Challenging now John Onkala as they head towards the Abbey chicane. So we are heading towards the window when these guys are going to be thinking about when to make this pit stop. It's a pretty straightforward pit entry. So as you come out the final corner, it's a peel gently right and a nice clean straight run into pit lane. Pit exit can be a little bit trickier. It's quite a tight right hand turn as you're on the inside of the pops corner initially, and then it's just all about how you feed into the traffic that comes thundering around, you know, a good 100 mile an hour quicker than you. So yeah, it's going to be, you know, thinking time for these guys as to when they're going to make that dive in.
Yeah, I always wonder if some people who are getting held up might think about jumping in just a lap early, but we know how much of an overcut you can get, so you're kind of stuck, aren't you, with your fuel strategy that you're on, if you can't quite get by. So I think there might be a couple of drivers getting a little bit frustrated out there right now and want the competition ahead of them to jump in earlier in what they're going to do. We look like we've got a problem. Ricardo Torres into the tyre wall, big time. Let's just take a little look back, see what that was. Just picked up the replay. We're going down Hangar Straight right now. You're gonna lose it. He just got onto the curb coming out of Stowe there and didn't get out of it at all. Hit the wall very, very hard. That will be his race over. Vortex car has seen better days.
Yeah, so that's the same position then he had his little half spin early on in the race. So it can be a tricky part of the circuit. I remember over the years in practice, spinning up the rears coming out of that Stowe sequence. Even though it's such a fast corner, you'd think you have so much downforce in the rear of a car, it can step out at times. So yeah, unlucky there for Ricardo. He was running very, very strong, of course, at the beginning of the race, up in third position. So I'm sure he will be extremely disappointed. Mac Backham just coming up on a laps car of Pepo de la Harris, running in 19th. So he's going to catch him at quite an opportune moment, really, coming onto the pit straight, I suspect.
Yeah, I dare say Pepo will just move on now over the way, perhaps, after Club. Cops, sorry. Get me names mixed up. Oh, maybe not. Just a bit too far back. Where the frustration can creep in for the leaders. Still got Montana 3.4 seconds back, so he will want to get past pretty quickly, and he's going to get there by now, so maybe cost him about a half a second maybe with the dirty air there, but nothing too much.
And Martin is looking to put John and Carla under more and more pressure. Cool, very, very different lines through the entry and Maggots. Martin all over the inside curb, car well and truly all four wheels off the ground for a split second as they head down Hangar Straight. John and Carlos sort of took a slight defensive line initially, but Martin is too far back to challenge for now, but he is certainly looking to push on and recover his position. Riku Alotello has not managed to have built as much of a gap over Diego Oliveira as I thought perhaps he was going to after those opening a couple of laps where he was running half a second quicker. So Diogo was actually half a tenth quicker around himself that time. So Diogo is doing a great job of hanging onto his coattails. Mac Backham starts another lap, continues round for now.
Yes, we reached that halfway stage. So I think most guys are going to be a couple of laps longer than the halfway mark. And I think the last race, the longest I saw was someone run to lap 30, but they were way, way longer than anybody else. Most were in sort of by 24, I think.
And so I'm watching John and Carla and Martin again as they come through Cops. Martin, I thought, might have been able to challenge a little bit easier as they come down the Hangar Straight this time, see what kind of run they both get through Maggots Beckett's. It's so easy just to miss an apex by a couple of feet and not get the exit out the corner that he needs, but all good for John O'Connor for one more lap, nice and clean.
Yeah, you could see actually the time that was lost sort of through that Beckett's Maggots complex there. It was nice and close, but just can't quite hold it close enough coming off of the final turn there onto Hangar Straight to get a run. You need to be sort of under 3 tenths if you can get a real shot, so really tricky. But back to 2 tenths as we break into Abbey.
So Cotavara is looking maybe a little bit stronger in this phase of the race. So he is the only car around him in the 1:19. So Daniel Beeder ahead was half a second, more than half a second slower. George Lee Wright had a poor lap; he was a second slower. So, Georgie Wright's dropped off the back of Cotavara a little bit now, and maybe Daniel Bieder is going to find himself under a little bit more pressure in the next couple of laps.
Yeah, let's see what the sector splits say as they cross the line. Daniel a little bit quicker actually that time, that last sector, so lap time still 2/10, so Pateri closing in definitely, but George Lee Wright losing out. Pateri back to a 20.4, so not quite as good lap as the last one, but still quickest out of the three drivers at the moment.
Yeah, and really nothing else doing through the field at the moment. It's just sort of holding our breath and waiting to see how this strategy is going to play out. So I am seeing George Lee Wright getting drawn back a little bit towards Juan Alfaro a little bit more as they come out of Club Corner, heading back towards Abbey again. They are battling over ninth position currently.
Yeah, just 8/10 of a second separate those. Need to jump back to the battle. This is very, very close. Martin, very, very close on John. That was just a 1/100 of a second as I flipped to the camera there. So those guys are having a great little battle, and it looks
John
like
in.
John in. Yeah. So first of the pit stops. Let's see what he does as far as pit time.
Yeah, so Martin is going to be very happy about that. Gives himself a little bit of clean air to work with and try and build a gap for once things shake out.
If I can do misty stop there. Trying to sort the camera angle out. Sorry about that. Fail miserably.
Yep.
All we can see is Armco.
Well, he is away and back onto the circuit with a nice empty track all around him.
8 seconds flat for the stop as well, so yeah, pretty reasonable stop. We'll have to see what the others are going to do. Cyprian went in as well, and actually he, if we just jump to him, so 8.4, our leader will jump to him.
And looks like everyone's coming in, so Montanez also is in from second position. Riku Alatalo and Diogo Oliveira continue on for one more lap.
Keep an eye on what Mac's doing as far as the stop goes. Expect it to be just a tiny little bit quicker than the 8 seconds we saw from John. No, looks like exactly the same 8 seconds as well. And
so,
Montanez, 8.5, lot slower.
Martino only managed to get one more lap in before he had to pit, so it's going to be interesting to see how he comes out with John Oncala pitting just that one lap earlier.
Yeah, we'll keep an eye on that actually, because where is John right now? He is just coming round the final turn actually, so in Luffield right now. Martin still stationary, needs that pit crew to work. That's 8.2 seconds, bit slower. I would expect that the advantage of the one lap might be negated there. It's going to be very close. There's John, side by side. He's got it. He's managed to hold on to that position. So, it's pretty good going, actually, to be fair. So, did the work in the actual pit stops. So, much easier to get the overcut. So, Martin would be a bit frustrated there. He thought he probably had that position wrapped up.
So, looks like pit stops has worked out pretty well for Mac Backham. He's got a nice clear track in front of him. But Jorge Montanez has come out behind Cotavara and Daniel Bieder, but no doubt they are going to be pitting imminently anyway. Riku Alatalo continues on, as does Diogo Oliveira still. So yeah, not worked out too great for Montanez, although say he was, he did have a comfortable buffer ahead and behind anyway, but yeah, both Bieder and Cotavara have continued on for now. Of course, he's going to be running a slightly heavier car, so perhaps it's not really going to affect his ultimate pace too much. We shall see how things all shake out. Nobody currently in pit lane at all.
Yeah, George Lee Wright pitted with the rest of the gaggle as well, 8.8 seconds. So Cotavara still out there, makes perhaps a little bit more sense why he was on him towards the early part, and Cotavara just held on once that fuel load started to come down a little bit, was able to sort of stretch his legs a little bit, so all starting to make a little bit more sense, I think.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how much time these two manage to gain over everyone else. They have run a good chunk longer now than most of those cars directly around them. But you can see that Matt Backham had gained you a whole pit stop.
There you go. In, I think he's having some big time connection problems, blinking out all over the place right now. Riku's in as well. Just hope that the Diego doesn't get disconnected. It looks like his connection settled itself back down now. So
Cotavara in, Daniel Beda continues up.
Yeah, Mac retains the lead. Tanaz is going to work out about 6 seconds behind him as well. Ricky will continue in third, just the drivers ahead of him still yet to pit. 7.5 second stop for Ricky, so those extra couple of laps saved about half a second in the actual pit stop. Plus the car will be on slightly fresher tyres as well, so might gain a tenth a lap as well at this point.
Right, so Cotavara is away, and he has got a nice clear bit of track around him, but he does feel like he's closed considerably on John Onkala and Martin Luzonord, so he has got a potential to maybe gather a couple of extra positions there, especially if they start squabbling. You know, so we saw how hard Martin was trying before the pit stops, and he's getting right in amongst the rear wing of John again. So yeah, potential for Petteri to move up a couple of spots.
Yeah, he got himself a free half a second gain in the pit stop there as well. Looks like he might have had a really good in lap too, because definitely closed up a lot. And yeah, fresher tyres now, so should have the higher ground. Like I say, he's just going to have to deal with that dirt. Yeah, he just needs those guys to carry on battling as they are at the moment. So, and yeah, I'm sure he'll sneak up on them and try and make a move.
Daniel Beda has pitted, so it'll be interesting to see where he comes out in relation to that battle there we were talking about. And still John and Carla being harassed pretty constantly by Martin as they now come out of Olaf Field and onto the front straight.
Yeah, Timu in as well.
Daniel Beda is out. This is going to be very, very close between himself and Petteri. I think Daniel Beda needs to get up to speed. Petteri comes round, cops, and as they were, pretty much. I think that was pretty much the gap that they had before the pit stop. So, yeah, this could all close together a little bit. Maybe in the second half could end up with a nice little four-car group.
Yeah, once again, Martin on John just can't quite get close enough. Doesn't have the legs. I don't know if he's running a little bit more downforce, a bit more extra wicker on the back of that Movano car to John. But of course, it could be that they're both minus 10. Anyway, it's always hard to tell. I think with the FW31, everybody seems to run the same aero trim everywhere, and yeah, just a little, maybe a click of wicker difference.
So George Lee Wright has lost a reasonable chunk of time over Cotavara, who he was directly behind last time round, and he's also lost one spot, I think, to Timu, but certainly close enough to think about challenging as they come into the last, 12, 13 laps?
Yeah, Timu got himself past. That was done in the pit stops as well. 7 second stop for Timu, so pretty much the quickest we've seen in today's race. Yeah, George 8.8, so you know, 1.8 second, that just goes to show all that time really disappeared too.
So we'll just have a quick run through the standings, unless Alex has got something to interrupt me with. Mac Backham is still comfortably in the lead in first position, and then Jorge Montanez in second. If anything, it feels like Montanez maybe is a little bit closer than when they went into the pits, but still a nice comfortable gap. Ricky Valentalo then in third, with Diogo Oliveira still in fourth, but having lost a little bit of time over Riku in the stops. John Onkala is still hanging on to fifth position, with Martin all over the back of him in sixth. They come through Priory. Daniel Beda then in seventh. Petteri Cotavara in eighth. Ignoring people who have yet to have pitted, we've then got Timo Valkyrie in ninth. and George D. Wright should shake out to be in 10th position.
As you pretty much guessed, we've got that four-car pack, although Pateri perhaps just a little bit off of it now, but Daniel Beeder definitely closed in enough to get in the fight. If Martin has a little move and slows both these drivers up, then he could take advantage and see a couple, see like a double car overtake or something like that. So definitely what would be going through my mind right now is for those guys to really start going at each other. Have a look at the sector times between them at the moment. So 28.1 for John Roncalo there, Martin 28.0, so just a little bit quicker in the first sector, but Daniel Beeder the fastest of all three into the 27s for that first sector. So definitely looking a little bit racy is Daniel.
And in fact Juan Luis Alfaro is not very far behind this group either now after completing his pit stop. So it'll be interesting to see if he can tag on to the back. I think all it's going to take is a little bit of squabbling, and all of a sudden everyone behind could easily close back up.
A little bit of a late move there from Martin. I thought for a minute he was going to go through at Priory there, but yeah, John saw him there and just sort of covered it off a bit late.
So they're about to begin lap 30, with John and Carla pretty much having the majority of the race so far hounded by Martin. So he's done a good job so far of not really making any significant mistakes that we have seen, keeping the pressure on Martin to make the move rather than it being placed into his lap. Daniel Beeder has not really closed on that last lap. In fact, he was a couple of tenths slower that time by, but Pateri was nearly 3 tenths quicker than Daniel as they come over the line. In fact, quickest of the lot, let me just double check, was indeed Juan Luis Alfaro, so he was quickest on his first flying lap after his pit stop.
Yeah, 120.6, so pretty decent lap out there. Timo doing similar sort of lap times further, one place further back as well. Interesting little battle forming up, three car one as well. We've got Klaus Cyprian and Kleber there as well, so three car battle that could go on for the rest of the race, I'm sure. Down in 13th, 14th, 15th at the moment, so great to see actually the field. While it's sort of strung out a little bit, everybody's having individual battles out there. Jump back to the battle for 6th place. The top 5 seems to definitely been spread right out now.
And again, John and Carla just keeping that sort of same half a second gap each lap round that you've been talking about before, that difficult wall of dirty air to try and get through is making it much harder for Martin. Again, that time by Daniel Beeder matched, in fact they were all pretty much identical, so all in the 0.4s that time by, and all the way back to Timo then, who was maybe just half a tenth slower, so yeah, all exactly the same as last time round. And so just scrolling back up through the field, Matt Bakken coming to start another lap, looking to begin lap 32, running in the mid to high 19s, as is Montanez coming onto the front straight now as well. Riku Alatello is matching their pace in those 19s, with Diogo Oliveira in 4th on a 20 flat. Then we've got our little group from 5th downwards, they're all running half a second slower. And again, Martin very, very close, going through Bridge and then into Priory. Is he going to look into Brooklyn? They had a little bit of a twitch maybe on entry, but very, very difficult unless, again, the car in front of you made a mistake.
Just reading some of the YouTube comments that are going on right now, and just need to tell the guys to change the subject, don't wind me up while I'm trying to do a commentary. Reminded me of that particular race that you're talking about, one World Cup race final. And yeah. Just looking back at the battle. Sorry, Lee. Changed the subject completely there, didn't I? But yeah, still Martin just can't seem to get close enough. Just seems to lose it through, like I say, through the Beckett's Maggot section. Seems to be a lot closer in the second half of the track. So I wonder if he is running perhaps just a tiny little bit extra click of wicker. So, you know, from here on out, he definitely seems to have the much better car, as he gets very loose coming out of club and That's going to make him a little bit vulnerable to Daniel Beda. Rear tyres are going to be on the warm side now for the exit of Abbey. Daniel really needs to close that gap and try and make a move right now.
It'll be interesting to see how easily Martin can close right back onto the gearbox again, if he can. And as you said, it's really going to be in this section of the circuit that if he wants to make a move, it's going to happen. It's going to take a little bit of a risky lunge for him to try and get it, presumably either into Priory or into Brooklands. That feels like his two best opportunities, even though you wouldn't necessarily consider those, you know, the most obvious places to overtake on a track. But like I say, coming out of Maggots Beckett's, he's just not going to be able to be close enough. And the same really coming out of Club leading to Abbey, it's going to be tough to be close enough to get the run. Looks like Cotavara has closed a little bit more second half of that lap on Daniel Beda, so he's looking to hang with his group again.
That was just crazy. I was looking at them as they were going through there, and the time that they lost, that Pateri lost through there, was a good 2 or 3 tenths just instantly, well, as soon as they started going into sort of the left-hand part of that three-corner complex. So it just seems like everybody really is struggling with that dirty air. They get within the 0.2 of a second, and there's just absolutely nothing they can do. And I know it's something that Eric had been trying to reduce a little bit, but not quite there. Still makes tracks like this very, very difficult to overtake. So yeah, hopefully we can get Eric Hudek onto it, and maybe season 3, just dial it down just a little bit more, make the racing all the more exciting.
And again, it'll be interesting to see once the new car comes along how much of an impact that has. You know, some of the regulations in real life have also supposedly about, you know, trying to help people to follow closer, but I wouldn't like to say we've really seen any evidence in that from the aerodynamics. It's more been from differences in engine power, which of course, again, we're not going to see here, being that we're all running McLarens, or we're going to be running McLarens. So, yeah, it's tough for these guys, but Martin has managed to close straight back onto the back of John Ancona after that little slight mistake, what, half a lap ago. So he's pulled a bit of a space on Daniel Beda as well. He's just going to be as close as he's been coming towards Stowe, but still not close enough. Pretty much identical lines going through there, and again gets pushed back into that little bit of a buffer again of dirtier.
Yeah, just doesn't quite have the speed there. It looked like he was peaking out a little bit early as well, so yeah, maybe 6th gear, 7th gear even, just a little bit too short. Oh, as he drifts into Abbey there as well, so definitely trying hard, but yeah, 6 laps to go. I think unless John makes a sizable mistake, he's not going to make this happen.
It looks like Daniel Benefield is out of the race, having just struggled a little bit with his connection, I think. So that is one less car trundling around. We currently have 17 runners, I believe, with Francisco Gutierrez running one lap down.
Pretty much this is the only real battles going on the track right now. Cyprian is still the second back from Klaus. Those guys have been pretty much as they were for quite some time now. But yeah, I think we're going to see a move. It's going to be in and around this group. Just need, I think if we see one side-by-side battle, it's all going to close up, and it's going to be a mass sort of move attempt. Something like that's going to go on. All these guys are just waiting for opportunity to get a run on each other.
Yeah, and Alfieri was quickest car around again that time, so he feels like he's closed onto the back of Tavara significantly more since the last time I'd looked. But yeah, we've split apart into these two little groups a bit more now as Daniel Beda's dropped off the back of Martin. Martin feels like he's a good chunk closer coming through Abbey this time, so it's just going to be a half a sniff for him coming perhaps into Brooklands if he feels particularly brave. But no, he didn't manage to close through those corners at all, which always going to be tricky, but say it feels like that's the strongest part of the circuit for him perhaps.
Yeah, pretty close coming out of Loughfield through Woodcote. He's surely got maybe an opportunity just to show his nose, try and put John off through Copse. Nothing happening. This is where he's going to lose all the time.
Yeah, like I say, as we watch him going through that sequence, you just see the gap just growing and growing, just peeling back nothing you can do, and you close again on hangar straight, but it's just not enough to get anything like a sniff, say, heading to Stowe. So John and Carl are still heading that fifth position from Martin, then Daniel Beeder in seventh, Petty Ricciotavara in eighth, and Juan Luis Alfaro in ninth. That's our little group of battles that we are focusing on really for these last four remaining laps.
There's a tiny little bit of chat just about the race time that we're streaming. I'm not sure we can do any earlier. The earlier race, Lee, we'll have to have a chat about that off air, but yeah, I think it's just going to clash with too much other stuff, I'm afraid, guys. So be too much hard work to jump from the World Championship straight to this. So, but yeah, we'll see what we can do, see how times to work out. But I think this is the one we're going to do for the moment. Martin again, 0.3 of a second going into Beckett's complex there, but exits it 0.5 seconds down. That seems to be the problem, that section. Everybody can close up, but once they get through there, and they need to be within that 0.3 if they're going to have any chance of a move down and into Stowe, they just can't quite make it stick. The only real driver we've seen make a move through there has been Riku, so we know that, well, to be fair, the guy's got some serious talent, so managed to make the dirty air work through there and got that move done.
Yeah, and it feels like Martins drops off a little bit more this lap than in previous ones, so he's got to work on closing back on that space again. Still no movement at all behind. Alfaro has latched himself onto the back of Potavara, but again, it feels like he's hit the same wall. We just see the same gap between all of those cars, really, as they come out of Luffield to start lap 38. Meanwhile, Mac Backham is two-thirds of the way around the lap, so he's just coming into Abbey as that battle for fifth position was coming through Cox.
Yeah, Cyprian got a little bit closer to the back of Klaus, but yeah, nothing much going on. Jump on board with Pateri, 3 laps to go. Just looks like this is going to be the final position, I think, Lee. The driver's all good enough really out there not to make any kind of mistake. Too far away for any sort of battling, so I think it's almost going to be, yeah, we're just going to see these last few laps out.
Yeah, I think I'd go along with that. I've been impressed with, you know, John being able to soak up all of this pressure, as I said, for the majority of the race. I've not really seen him, say, you know, make an error that gave Martin even a hint of a chance, really. And, yeah, that can be a very...
Oh, talking of mistakes, Pateri makes one. Here comes Alfaro up the inside into Bridge. He's made the move. Pateri's got one opportunity to get back at Brooklyn's. Just can't do it. So yeah, there was me. Just sorry, I think that was proper commentator's curse at his best there.
That's it, right on cue. No further changes of positions, and yeah, Cotavara drops back that one spot. It'll be interesting to see if Alfaro, now that he's got a little bit of a clear track, if he can close back on the cars ahead or not. But yeah, we've just got a couple of laps remaining now. Martin, again, it feels like maybe he's dropped back a little bit more on John now, and so he's just gonna bring it home, as is all the guys ahead of him. You know, they're all spaced out pretty cleanly. Mac Backham's still in first, Montanez in second, catching up with a back marker at the moment. Rico Alatello in third position. Oliveira had a quiet second half of the race after hanging on to Riku pretty well in the first half. And then Martin has closed back again a little bit as they come out of Club now. And in fact, he's got a great exit coming out of Club. It's as close as he's been as we head to Abbey. In fact, John does feel the need to move around in the breaker zone a little bit and defend. What was I just saying about Martin settling? This is, you know, as close as we've seen him there in the second half of the lap. Again, it's going to take something mega to make a move in this final complex. But looks like John's got things covered for one more lap. So they're about to begin their final lap. The leader's got to be halfway around that already by now.
Yeah, Matt just going through Vale now into a Club. probably the hardest corner on the circuit, very easy to get a little bit loose, no problems for the Radicals driver.
So it looks like Martin is still pushing hard. He has managed to close a little bit on John, but again going to suffer this normal issue as they come through Maggots Beckett's, and I think we'll check back in on then as they get towards the end of a lap and see how close he's managed to get. So Mac Backham coming around the final sequence of corners, as soon as he made that move on Montanez on the very first corner, I think, wasn't it, coming into Copse or maybe into Maggots, yep. Then that looked like a pretty comfortable race result for Mac Backham, so congratulations. First position, pretty comfortable. Montanez, after losing that spot, yeah, never looked threatened anywhere else. Second position for him. Ricco Alatello came through the field pretty cleanly. Storming start, made up a good fistful of positions at the very, very start. But Ricco, just noticed, Alex, Ricco suddenly ended up right with Diogo there. Ricco Alatello, 1 minute 23.8 that lap, so missed that, but he had an issue.
And it was here 21.
Comes Martin, Alex, you want to be seeing that? John Uncola on the inside as they come through. Priory Martin trying to hang it out. He's got that move done. I think he's got the inside line now. The final corner coming through left field. Who's going to get the drive off the corner? They're side by side. I think Martin's just going to hang on to it. John Uncola. Unlucky, John. Great job, Martin. I thought John had that covered, but Martin got that move made just where we'd been talking about all race, really. It was coming through Bridge and Priory that he had that chance. And we'll look at the replay in a second. I missed the build up to it. But he did manage to dive up inside like I was waiting for.
Yeah, that was definitely where his car was quickest. We're just going to bring it up on replay now. Let's jump on board as well for that complex. And it looked like John got a little bit out of shape through Abbey, and that's what's let Martin get the run. He's around the outside of Priory there, so not easy at all. Managed to hold it through Brooklyn's. That gives him the high ground for Luffield. Just is in there and is able to get a good drive out of Luffield, and then just hugs it nice and tight through Woodcote and uses the short line to the racing line as well, just to make doubly sure that he gets it. So yeah, just a little mistake there from John. Perhaps that little bit of pressure just on the last lap. We know how immense it can be when the driver's just that half a second behind, and just got the better of him and failed with the exit of Abbey, and that's Martin just took that opportunity. Great job.
Yeah, and just seeing my delayed replay on the stream coming up, and it looked like maybe John was a little bit cautious coming through Bridge as well. It feels like he could have closed onto the apex, but just gave Martin that car's width space to come up inside, and that ultimately was that what then cost him. I'd be interested, Alex, to see a replay, or for you guys to see a replay of Ricco coming through Maggots on the final corner. I believe that's where he had an issue that nearly cost him that position at the last gasp.
Yeah, let me see if I can jump back and find that.
So whilst we get that lined up, quick clarification of the race results. And so Mac Backham, first position, 9.5 seconds ahead of Jorge Montanez. Ricco Alatello then did finish in third, but only 0.3 ahead of Diogo Oliveira in fourth. Martin then did finish in fifth position after sitting behind John for the majority of the race. Daniel Bida then in seventh, with Han Alfro in eighth. Petteri Cotavara will be disappointed to have lost one spot, finishing ninth. Timu then finished in tenth, with George Lee Wright dropping off a little bit towards the end of the race in 11th. Johnny Takanen is in 12th, Kleber Toffolo in 13th, Klaus Simits in 14th, Cyprian in 15th, and every other runner was a lap or more down.
Yeah, so just got the replay up on screen now. We're just exiting Abbey. You're right, he's quite a way away at this point, is Diego, so you shouldn't think of any real problems there. So into Brooklyn's, Diego pushing hard. That's a little bit of a wide line there through Brooklyn's. That really set it. Just a bit of a poor line, really. I think more than anything, I wonder if Ricky's a bit marginal on fuel, so he's having to sort of coast into some of these corners, just missing his braking and those last few laps, very slow. Looks like he was just sort of saving more than anything.
Cool, well that was a pretty straightforward race for the top three cars, and a big group running in the middle of the pack for the majority of the race. But so ultimately, not a great circuit to see these cars running, unfortunately, Alex, as we were talking about. It's just super close to get a run and to get up alongside these cars. It really took an error from a car in front for any of the overtakes that we saw. But no doubt we're going to see more variation as we go into the next races. Next week, looks like the guys are going to be running at Circuit of the Americas, Grand Prix layout, of course, 34 laps. An interesting circuit, that one. You know, it's a little bit difficult to maybe find your line in certain places. Certainly be interesting to see how the guys cope.
Just looking at the results and the points for those that might be tuned in. 4,085 strength of field. Mac got 258 points, so lower than what he had got so far. Drivers who improved their points are Diego Oliveira, 219. Martin got 206. John Oncala there, 193. Daniel Bida, 180. Alfro got 167, and Pateria with 154. George Lee Wright, 129. So it seems to me the average that drivers are looking for is around that 190 mark for a sort of a top 15 spot. But so Daniel Bida on 180, he might want to race again. I don't know. So, but slightly less points than we had at the race previous, but I'm sure some of those drivers up there with 200 plus will be dead chuffed with those.
And of course, yeah, we're still on the Saturday, so they've all got tomorrow night still to try and get these points before they presumably switch their attention then to COTA for next week. That'll be week 9, so they're really then coming into the critical point of the season, and it'll be interesting to see how maybe some of these guys running for Pro for the first time cope with the pressure of I need 10 more points this week, and how do you make sure you get that result and find that balance between staying out of trouble but making the moves when it's needed. So it'll be interesting to see how the guys are coping and how different levels of experience maybe can affect that as well.
Yeah, it's going to be great to watch. Thanks, Lee, for stepping in and doing this. And so you're not going to be here next week, but hopefully myself and Conrad Venter, any of the Skip Barber 2K guys, will remember Conrad. So should be fun nonetheless. But we'll be back same time next week.
What is so important about driving faster than anyone else?
A lot of people go through life doing things badly. Racing's important to men who do it well. In racing, it's life. Anything that happens before or after, it's just waiting.